power of money is the same as value. Money. And the value of money depends on supply and demand. So, you have supply. What determined, that was yesterday, the supply of money. What determined the supply of money? Chapter 4. Like 24 hours ago? That's so low. Anybody? Productivity. Well, the supply of money, well, first, what is it? Determined is by gold, supply of gold. How much gold you have. Supply. Which in turn is determined by productivity, is dependent on the economy itself and grows with the economy. It's impossible to grow faster than the economy. If gold goes faster than the economy, it means that supply of gold relative to other goods will be lower, and as a result, it will not be profitable to mine gold. It will be profitable to grow chicken or grow rice or make computers. So gold cannot rise faster than the economy. Because if it rises faster, its value will fall and it will not be profitable. There will be a lot of other things that are more profitable. And the other thing is government.
Paper money.
That's it. Now, this one we can call nice and short, but absolutely correctly. We just call this money printing. And that's it. These are the main factors that determine money supply. Now we go through money demand. This will be chapter 4. This is chapter 5 of demand. And demand for money is more complicated. Hey, hello. I'm going to start, okay? I'm on chapter 5. Number one is supply of goods. And services. I'll be explaining this. That's page 59. Number two, let's take a look. Payment frequency. Page 60. Next one is clearing systems. Are you zooming in? Good enough so you can see. You got zooming nice and good so that the letters come big. Clearing. This is page 63.
Confidence.
Number four is
confidence.
Confidence in money. That's page 65. And number five is?
Inflationary.
For deflationary, inflationary expectations. And that's page?
66.
66. And this is what we're going to be basically covering today. So, we go in here and do now 5.1. Now, I already explained this before and I'll try to repeat it again. People confuse demand with, and it is not desire. All right? Oh, I desire a lot of money. I wish. Yeah, you can wish and dream all you want, okay? But that's not demand for money. You can desire as much as you want, but it's not a demand. And a lot of people want money, right? You all sure want money. But what you want has nothing to do with demand. Just because you want it, it doesn't make a demand. Demand means that you must supply something in return. I have a genuine demand for money because I am supplying labor. I come to work every day. I'm teaching and I'm expecting in return for something of value. So demand comes, what is money? Money is a generally accepted medium of exchange. So demand for money comes, the first main way is from exchange. If you exchange something, you demand money. Well, that's it. If you sell water, you demand money. If you sell a service, you demand money. So exchange is in two forms. Goods, you sell food at a restaurant, you demand money in return, okay? You sell rice, you demand money. And the other one will be service. You sell a massage. Well, that's a service, okay? It could be a rock concert. One of the simplest examples of a service is go and watch a movie. When you watch a movie, it's just a service, okay? So these are all examples of if you sell a service, you demand in return money. So demand in return of money is coming from a, which is the same thing. These two are the same thing, from a sale. You offer something of value in return for money. Now, you may sell your motorcycle and demand money from that. You may sell your phone, your watch, you may sell whatever you have in return. But demand is determined by something that you offer of real value in exchange for money. That's demand for money. Alright. Usually, when people buy a house, and that's important to understand, is they don't demand money. When you buy a house, you get rid of money. You sell money, you buy the house. So right now in Cambodia, demand for money is low, paradoxically low. As more and more and more people rush to buy houses, that's a clear indicator that they don't demand money. I mean, they want money, right? Yeah, sure, you all want to have. But when it comes to money and house, people demand house more and they demand money less. Again, it is a relative, only a relative to one another. So, demand comes from an exchange. So, if goods increase, you want to sell more goods, you will have a higher demand for money. So, let's write this out. When goods, supply of goods, and supply of services increases. So you just produce more rice, you know. There was better rain, there was a better crop, there's a lot more rice. If you have more rice produced, you will sell the rice, and in return, you have an increased demand. So, rising supply of goods results in rising demand for money. It's that simple. Now, we already covered chapter 3. Rising demand for money means what? That was chapter 3.
Falling prices,
and I'll do the intermediate step. Rising demand for money means purchasing power of money goes up and prices go down. So, if you produce more rice, the result will be an overall increase in the purchasing power of money and eventually falling prices. Falling prices of rice, but also falling prices of other things. Because, yes, if you produce more rice, sure, prices will fall given the same demand. But at the same time, purchasing power of money will increase and other prices will fall. So this is a great example to understand how a major increase in the supply of one particular good can result in the falling price of another good, or the falling general prices just because purchasing power of money goes up and prices go down. That's important to understand. In other words, money remains exactly the same, but if you produce more, prices will fall and everybody will be wealthier. So, rising goods, meaning supply of goods, and rising services means people more wealth. Of course. Means rising wealth. That's what people want. People want more rice, you want more houses, you want more cars, you want more iPhones, whatever, watches, whatever the things you really want is more wealth, not more money. The only reason you want more money is so you can buy more lipstick, right? Okay? So, you don't want money for the sake of money. You want money so you can eventually buy more goods and services, okay? Whether it's 1 hour from now or 1 week from now. The demand for money rises mostly so you want to buy more later. Okay? Okay, so this is number one, and that's it. Rising supply of goods and services causes increasing wealth, causes the demand for money to rise, and overall prices to fall. Now, what will cause goods and services to rise? We covered it yesterday indirectly, and that will be productivity. Productivity, rising productivity, will cause increase in goods and services. So, even if you don't increase If you don't increase the money supply, rising overall productivity will eventually lead to falling prices. Let's write this out because that's one of the important conclusions, that rising productivity causes falling prices. The fall in price and having the same amount of money is an indirect way of which people share the increased wealth in the economy. In other words, you have now so much construction of houses everywhere. This is a big, this city is like there, right across the window, is a big construction site. Why it has such a phenomenal increase in supply of houses, why prices go up for houses? How could it be? How could it be? Isn't that a paradox? Well, sure, the answer is yes, supply of housing is rising, but demand for money is falling. People don't want to keep the money. They want to spend it, buy a house. And I'll be explaining over here why. Okay, it's coming up later. So that's 5-1. All right. That's number one. Now, 5-2. What's 5-2? Payment frequency. Payment frequency. I'm just making this example for you to understand. Suppose I have my monthly expenditures to be around $1,000. $1,000 is an easy number, okay? $1,000 monthly. These are my expenditures. That's what I spend about a month. Well, how much money do I demand and want to hold and keep so I can do my spending? And the short answer is, depends how often I get paid. If I get paid once a year, it's called yearly. What is my demand for money? I get paid only once a year. Well, at first, right after the payment, I need to hold $12,000 so I can have enough money to spend for the next 12 months. Well, after a month, I've been spending and spending and spending, and I have spent about $1,000. My next month demand is let's do this.
11,000.
Yeah, 11,000.
Okay.
So, after one more month, I'll need or demand how much?
10,000.
10. It's common sense. Nothing really special. And then 9. And then all the way to the last month, I'll need
1,000.
So, my demand for money steadily falls over time. Early on, it is very high, and as time goes on, my demand falls because I'm going to get my payment sooner. Now comes a simple question, and it's a simple math. What is my average demand of money throughout the year? It is a simple mean average of these numbers. About, what is it? About?
1,000.
How much? It's a number. 600?
No, average is
Average is what?
1,000.
How much? Come on, guys. Calculate a simple average. Is this where we are?
It's about 1,000.
Hey guys, what's the average between 2 and 3? What's the average?
2.5.
2.5. Well, what's the average between 1, 2, and 3?
2.
Okay, well, what's the average between 1, 2, 3, and 4?
2.5.
What's the average between 1, 2, 3.5?
3.
3. Okay, well, what's the average between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to 10?
5.5.
So the average here is in thousands. Let me get my little thing. Wow. Okay. It's called making a progress here. My average demand over the year will be 5,500. Okay. That's it. Now, what about monthly? At the beginning of the month, my demand is 1,000. At the end of the month, it's 0. Now, if you want to do it day by day, okay, it's going to be 1,970, 960, and so forth. Or you can do it by week. At the beginning is 1,000. By week, next week is 750. Next week is 500. Next week is 250. And what's my average about? You just plus, plus, plus?
Isn't that 6,500?
Yeah.
Where?
The average.
Yearly
average.
Well, you can calculate, it's yes, maybe 6. Okay, let's put it, make it 6. Okay, that's good enough, thank you. All right, so what's the average over here? You just say plus, 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 divide by 4. About? Yeah, about, I'll demand about 500. So, this is 1,000, and this is 2,000. 2,500. So it's going to be a little over $500. Just about, I say, about $500. Well, that's my demand, fine. What if I get paid weekly? Weekly. What's my demand? If I get paid weekly, I demand about $250. Well, how much I demand the next day? Well, I'm spending on average, what, about $40, right? $35, okay? So, the next day, let's just say $30 on average. $160. All right? And then, 130 and so on. So what is my average demand for money? What's my average demand for money here? Well, it's about 125 or so, okay? $130, okay? Again, the exact number is not important. What is important is here, I need $6,000 on average to keep. Here, I need 10 times less. Here, I need 20 times less, or even more. It's actually 40 times less, okay? Well, on average, between a year and a week, in a year, I have 52 weeks, so I will demand 50 times less money on average if I was getting paid weekly. Alright? Well, what if I'm getting paid daily? Many workers in many countries are getting paid daily, meaning at the end of the day they get paid, okay? Well, What's my 10? Well, on $1,000 divided by 30 days, let's say, okay, let's do this little trick. I work 25 days a week, I'm gonna have some, you know, weekends, and my salary, my demand is $1,000, 25 days. So daily, I'll demand $40. And throughout the day, I'll be spending on my food, I pay this, I pay that. So suddenly, if my daily demand at the beginning of the day is 40, in the middle of the day, my average for the day will be about
20.
About, again, remember, these are approximate numbers, but they give you an extremely important idea that the frequency of payment is absolutely important. So, now the question comes, can frequency of payment explain inflation in the economy? Is it possible that as people get paid more frequently, there will be a rise in prices? All right, so let's write it out. If frequency increases, what happens to demand for money?
Demand for money.
Well, frequency in a year, so once a year, this is 12 times a year, this is 52 times a year, and this is 365 times a year. As the frequency increases, demand for money falls. You don't need as much. So, demand for money falls. Purchasing power of money will fall, and prices will rise. So, an increase in frequency will cause prices to rise. Now, can this cause inflation a year from a year to a year? And a simple answer, no. You can increase from monthly to weekly, you will get what's called one-time inflation. Inflation will rise one time to reflect the new frequency, and then demand will stabilize. Okay. So, this frequency of payment can explain what we call a one-shot inflation. One-shot is the same as one-time inflation. Yet, inflation will increase once, and then it will stabilize. Actually, now, let's try and use basic common sense about frequency. Does frequency change a lot?
No,
it's remarkably stable. Frequency depends first and foremost on culture. Japanese will have a different culture from Chinese, from Europeans, and mostly depends on its history. Frequency cannot possibly change much because you need the whole structure of the economy, you need culture, mentality, you know, people's gotta change. Now, frequency can change if there is a war, okay, then everything. If there's a civil war, suddenly frequency can change a lot. But otherwise, in a normal running economy, frequency stays almost the same. It doesn't change much, okay? So, that's frequency cannot explain significant shifts in demand and significant shifts in inflation. Yes, if the economy changes from monthly to weekly, there will be a one-time transition, and that's the end. So, that's number two. It's important to understand that as people get paid more often, demand falls. Now, the opposite may occur. As more and more people get paid on a monthly basis instead of weekly basis, the frequency can increase. Now, here's a great example of frequency. A farmer who gets paid twice a year, meaning farmer grows the crop, he gets paid after he sells the crop, will have a higher demand for money than a weekly worker, okay? Because he needs to feed the family for 6 months. That's common sense, okay? So farmers may maintain higher cash balances and willing to hold on to them for 2 or 3 months. If you get paid weekly, you don't need a lot of cash. And a lot of times what happens in poor people in America, that's extremely common, part of American culture, and tell me if it's the same here, is people get paid weekly. They get paid on Friday evening, that's the last day of the week. On Saturday, they go shopping, and by Saturday evening, money's all gone. Okay? And then on Sunday, no more money. So their demand for money is like almost zero. They get paid and a couple hours later, you know, they bought their food, they paid their bills, whatever, electric and all the other stuff, and then they don't need any much money anymore, okay? So the guy may get paid $500 a week, and he'll spend $480 on Saturday, and he'll be left with $20 for the rest of the week, okay? But he bought whatever he needed, okay? Now, that's part of culture and mentality. It doesn't speak good or bad, that's how people are, okay? So, that's number two. Number three is clearing systems. So, number two, that was again, let me copy again, page 16. Clearing systems. Clearing system is a system where you clear payments. Clear payments. Clear is kind of like cancel. It goes like this. I owe you $5 and you owe me $4, okay? My demand for money is $5 because I gotta pay you $5, and your demand for money is $4 because you gotta pay me $4, okay? If we had a clearing system, we say, oh, I owe you $5, you owe me $4, this is the same as me owing you $1. If we have a system where it will calculate and say, oh, you just gotta pay him $1, means my demand of money, for money from $5 drops to $1. And your demand of money from $4 drops to $0. So a simple clearing system reduces demand of money from 9 to 1. All right, well, let's try something else. Let's say you owe this guy $10. She owes you $10, and you owe her $10, okay? Now, you got 4 people owing each $10. Without a clearing system, it's the same as a total demand of $40. But, oh, you owe 10, you owe 10, you owe 10, it's the same thing as you owe this guy 10. So if there is a clearing system, you're supposed to get from one person 10 and give another person 10, your net is 0. You expect from her 10, and at the same time, you gotta pay this guy 10, so the net is 0. Well, let's draw a picture. A must pay B $10. B must pay C $10. And C must pay D $10. Okay? So demand is 10, 10, 10, 30. Okay?
Well, but...
Now, if we have a clearance system, this is the same as A to B, B to C, C to D. This is the same as A paying directly to D $10. So, without clearing, demand is 30. Blue. So, no. Clearing, demand 30. With clearing, demand is 10. All right. That's direct here. Well, now imagine even more weird situation, which can happen in a small town. Now suppose that D owes to A $10. Okay. That's the second scenario. If D owes to A, what's the total demand without clearing? 40. And what's the total demand with clearing? Zero. That's it. So, the more complete the clearing system, the lower the demand for money. So, clearing systems, I can write it straight up here. If clearing systems improve and develop, causes demand for money to fall. And clearing systems will result in higher prices. Why? If you got a clearing system, you don't need as much money to hold. If you don't need to hold it, you will spend it. So, if a better clearing system will improve spending, people like don't need so much money. You can just spend most of it because you don't need much of it. So, clearing system can, well, do lower demand for money, increase the overall prices, and now comes the question, can clearing systems cause or trigger sustained inflation and sustained increases in prices? No, obviously not. Clearing system takes decades, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years to develop. It's a very, very, very slow process, okay? You need to get everybody, and rich, and poor, and citizens, and farmers, and young, and old. It's almost impossible to improve quickly. The process is extremely slow. So clearing systems sure affect over the course of 5 or 20 years, yes, but over the course of 3 months or 6 months or a year, not much will change in a system. Now, somehow, maybe the government will say, okay, all salaries must be paid in the bank as a bank deposit, and it's a law. And one time, everyone's salary gets transferred into the bank, from the bank to the bank account, okay? Then, potentially, there will be a somewhat lower demand. That will be an improvement in the clearing systems overall, okay? But again, it will be a one-time, single event, and after that event, there will be little to no improvement later on. So, clearing systems are a factor, but they're not an important long-term factor. They're not a significant factor that can significantly affect inflation. They can have only a small effect. Same thing with frequency. Frequency is remarkably stable. It affects only a little bit. Let's see what's next, because the big... I'm missing here one piece. example of a clearing system, and actually I'll spend the last 5 minutes, is to explain credit cards. It's just a piece of plastic, okay, which the bank gives you that they can use for spending money. A credit card, first of all, does not increase supply of money. There is no increase in supply of money when you have a credit card. That's number one. Number two, when you use a credit card, what happens is the following. You have buyer, yeah, seller, and you got a bank. Okay, the bank issues the credit card to the buyer. The way it works is very simple. You buy something for $100. This means that you borrow from the bank $100. So the buyer borrows from the bank $100, okay? And then the bank loans you, it's the same as you borrow from the bank, and the bank pays for you. The bank pays for you. So essentially, you borrow from the bank, and the bank makes payment for you. Now, the simple question is, do credit cards lower demand for money? And the answer is yes. Sure, people who have a credit card in their pocket wear a lot less money. So, if you don't have a credit card, maybe have to carry with you $50 to $100. If you have a credit card, maybe you can carry $10 or $20, okay? Because you want to go somewhere to a restaurant, $17, you pay with a credit card. You want to buy gasoline, you pay with a credit card. So, if you can use, the more you use your credit card, the less demand for money you have, okay? So credit cards are an important part of what we could call a clearing system, okay? Where you lower your demand for money. Well, here's the next thing. So you buy one time, you buy two times, you buy three times, you buy this month 10, 20 times, and you owe to your bank, let's say $300. At the end of the week, you get your salary $500, and the first thing you do is, as soon as you get the $500, you walk to the bank and you pay a credit card. When you pay a credit card, means, again, the same thing. Instead of holding the $500 and spending it on a daily basis, you immediately pay to the credit card company, meaning to the bank, and again, you keep your balances low when you get paid, and you don't need as much money. So, credit cards clearly and obviously reduce demand for money, okay? That's a very important observation. And again, with credit cards, you have an improvement in the clearing system. So, this is the same as you paid to the seller. Now, the seller gets his money from the bank, he will use it and pay somebody else, some supplier. And it's possible that supplier is in the same bank. So as soon as the seller gets the money from the bank, he'll send them right back to his supplier. Okay? So, or even better, the supplier, knowing that the seller may be a big, like, supermarket, like Lucky, okay? Supplier says, oh, Lucky's working with this bank. Then the supplier will open account with the same bank, okay, as Lucky. So, again, you make the payment, seller gets the money, he puts it in his account, and then the supplier gets immediately paid, okay? So, again, supplier gives them credits. to the seller, okay? He gives some credit to the seller. There's no demand for money, okay, here. Now, the buyer buys on credit. There is no demand for money. And then, as the bank gets the money back, there is no demand for money, okay? So, you minimize the amount of money that is needed in a simple clearing system like this. All right, so clearing system is where we are, and we continue after the break, 10 minutes, with the last two factors on demand for money.